Welcome to STAREAST Virtual. Thank you for joining us. Over the course of the next 2 days, we'll broadcast 12 great presentations streaming live from STAREAST 2012 in Orlando, Florida. For this event, I'm your host and moderator, Francesca Matu. First, let's review how to navigate through the conference. Clicking the tabs in the top navigation bar will take you to each room within the conference, including the Expo Hall, Resource Center, Networking Lounge, and Presentation Hall. In the Expo Hall, visit sponsors to learn the latest in top testing solutions. Chat with a sponsor representative to get all the details you need. The Resource Center contains downloadable documents such as articles, white papers, and fact sheets. Save items in your virtual briefcase, and when you're ready to download them, click on the briefcase icon at the bottom of your screen and then click Download. Take a moment to chat with other virtual attendees as well as presenters in the networking lounge through group chats, discussion boards, and more. And be sure to take our survey and let us know what you think of the conference. Your feedback will help us improve your experience. And visit the Prize Center to learn about earning points to win one of 3 100 Amazon gift cards. Visit the Game tab to play our STAREAST trivia game. Now, currently, you're in the Presentation Center. All of the live presentations will broadcast from here. You'll see 3 tabs, Wednesday, Thursday, and Interviews, and check each tab for presentation listings each day. And check out our news feature, Live Interviews with Conference Speakers, which will be streamed periodically throughout the days between the presentations. Now, if you need help at any time, please visit the Tools tab and click on Help Desk. We're available to help troubleshoot any technical difficulties you may have. And of course, we hope you have a great experience at STAREAST Virtual. All right, now welcome to our first presentation titled Bridging the Gap, Leading Change in a Community of Testers, featuring Keith Klain of Barclays Capital Global Test Center. Before we begin, I would like to explain how to participate in today's event. This presentation contains streaming video and content, so to optimize bandwidth, please be sure to close any unnecessary applications that may be running in the background. You'll notice a widgets toolbar at the bottom of your console. Click on the appropriate widget to view the speaker bio and presentation abstract. Click the Handouts widget to download the speaker's presentation to your virtual briefcase. Loving the presentation? Well, send us a tweet through our Twitter feed through the Twitter widget. Also, please send us your feedback about the presentation via our short 4-question survey. Now remember, to submit a question, use the moderated chat panel. Technical questions will be answered within the chat, and we will try to get to each of your questions to the speaker here live at our conference during the Q&A portion of the presentation. And in just a minute or two, Keith will be joining us on stage. So at this point, I will turn things over to the floor.
He's the head of the Global Test Center for Barclays Capital, which provides functional and non-functional software testing services to the investment banking and wealth management business, and that will explain the suit that he's wearing. With over 15 years of experience in software testing, Keith has built and managed global test teams for financial services firms in the US and the UK and now in the Asia Pacific area. He's also worked as a software quality management practice director for an international technology consultancy. Would you welcome Keith Klain?
That's 2 comments from Lee about how people look, eh? Okay, so what I want to go through today, before I do that, I want to do a couple of acknowledgments. I get asked pretty frequently about how we have the success we're having with the test center at Barclays. And firstly, that's down to a lot of people who are working really, really hard every day, from the support of the senior management team down to my management team, and really, really down to the people who actually do the testing every day in and out, and it really, not very much credit belongs to me. They've trusted me to take a different path on how we like to improve things, and so far it seems to be working. So that's one thing I wanted to point out. Secondly, a lot of what you're going to see up here is, one, answering questions about how we position testing within the larger organization. And then two, a big chunk of this is taken directly from what we call our induction program, where we basically tell people what's expected out of them and how we think we should do things and how we want to approach testing to continue on the path we're on. So lucky for you, after that, you can all consider yourselves honorary members of the GTC. And lucky for me, those roles come with exactly no pay and benefits. So off we go. So how do you lead change in a community of testers? Now, fortunately for me, one of my larger screw-ups happened rather early in my career. And it wasn't one of those epic failures that, you know, was career-altering or career-ending, fortunately. But it was close enough so that when you came in the morning and everyone was watching you, is there some feedback on the mic or is that just the room? I'll forget about it then. Okay. Right. So when you came in the morning and you were doing your morning greetings and you're like, hey, Steve, how's the weekend? It was kind of head back down the desk and nobody really wanted to acknowledge that you were walking through the hallways. So then when I got back to my desk and had worked out that what had happened over the weekend and that it was kind of ultimately my responsibility and it cost the firm some money, I realized that I was going to have to at some point go talk to my boss. So he called me into his office and he said, Keith, I'm not going to fire you today, but I want you to go back to your desk and reflect on a couple things. The first one being, you know, in this business, you are either a bug or a windshield. So I want you to figure out which one you are. And secondly, I want you to figure out how to never, ever, 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 ever let this happen again. So I think as I bowed and left the room rather quickly, thinking that I would not have to update my resume, on the way back I kind of realized that, you know, and it hit me later in my career, those two points kind of encapsulated anything you want to know about leading change. And that is, firstly, you know, are you a bug or a windshield? You know, what is motivating you, right? You can't get anybody to do anything, to change any behavior until you understand what is motivating them. And secondly, how are you going to get anybody to do anything, right? Unless it's through propagation. So I was challenged with making sure nobody else made that similar mistake. So with those two things, figuring out what motivates people, and as well, you know, how do we get them to do it because they want to do it, it's in their self-interest, that's really the art of leading change. So what does that have to do with a test center? So I think as, what is the test center, first of all, right? So I think as I get older, to quote the movie, I stereotype because it's more efficient. We're a group of people spread across the globe who do software testing for pretty much every different business and asset class in Barclays Capital and Wealth Management. And those can be grouped into some high-level buckets. Test strategy and management, you know, scope management, interacting with the business and the project teams. You guys, this is your bread and butter, you know what this is. So we do that. We also execute the tests ourselves with a couple partners. Functional and non-functional test automation. We've got some specialist teams that work on those things and front-to-back testing for a few core flows and end-to-end asset classes. But what was really, you know, about 2 years ago, the drivers for change? The first one being test management priorities, and I would say that's probably more along the lines of turning the dials on what our focus was, really understanding what is the role of testing in our organization. There was lots of stuff, programs and process improvement initiatives happening, but I think the focus on the test management layer was a bit off. Second driver for change, which I think at any point somebody who's done software testing has struggled with this, which is visibility into non-test related activities. What else is going on in the organization? What is the business? And what do we, how do we meant to support them? A lot of times that is the result of where we get tucked into an organization. If we're underneath a developer or we are just one specific product or project related, so it's a difficult challenge, and I think as well, a lot of people in testing don't feel empowered to go seek that information themselves. The last point is around, and my team hears me bang on and on and on about this, is collaboration and reuse. And not so much encouraging it, but institutionalizing it so that it's one of your first reference points for when you come across a problem. Not trying to solve it immediately yourself, but looking where we might be able to leverage things that have happened elsewhere in the organization. So those are the main things that were driving us for have a change program. I'm going to draw a point of a correlation to what we were trying to do and what I generally see after doing this kind of for 15 plus years in anger on just software testing in the industry. And I recently attended a testing summit in Europe, and a research analyst gave a report and talked us through it for about an hour and a half. And they had polled about 200 different companies in Europe, and aside from asking the kind of bog standard testing questions around how much are you going to spend, are you centralizing, decentralizing, they also polled these senior executives on their view, their perspective on their testing group and what they thought of it. And I got to say, it was possibly one of the most depressing things I had heard in a very long time. So their view was, one, we don't understand their business. This is the business telling what they think about software testing. We don't understand their business. We're too slow. We're too expensive. And if we could just get rid of all these damn people and automate everything, life would be so much better. So needless to say, as that's kind of my trade, it was a bit depressing. But I think after 15 plus years of process improvement, maturity models, certifications, metrics programs, clearly something ain't getting through. It's not working. And I think that's one of the main drivers for why we decided to approach our change program as the way it is. So I think if you want to change anything, and I am a bit of a student of change programs and how you get people to motivate people having to manage large teams, I think it's really important to outline what your values are. And this may seem a bit management consulty-like, but I think it's really important because if you don't understand what your values are, your values drive everything you do, where you spend your time, where you spend your money, how you allocate your resources. And if you don't define those organizationally, you aren't going to be able to get people to align that way. So there's a really good book called Principles by a guy named Ray Dalio who runs one of the most successful hedge funds in the world out in Connecticut. And he wrote this book, and it's you know, there's some useful things in there. So what I did was distill some of that down so that we can start to identify as a group what we want to consider our core values. And here's what they are. So the first one, honesty, right? First with yourself and then with each other, right? And not to tolerate dishonesty with each other, because if you do, we are not going to be able to figure out what's working and what's not working, right? If you're not honest with yourself, if you look at most of the problems you have, and what's that saying, you know, the only common denominator in all your dysfunctional relationships is you, if you're not honest with yourself, you can't fix what's broke. And that takes a lot of self-reflection so that we can then start to identify our strengths and weaknesses. But if we're not being honest about that, we aren't going to change anything. We're not going to be able to change people's perception of our value to the organization. Secondly, integrity. All right? Learn from your mistakes to have the right to have an opinion. I like the saying, all people are created equal, but not all opinions. You know? I will trust my test manager who runs our connectivity team, who's been doing it day in, day out for the last 10 years and knows that space like the back of his hand, before I'll trust somebody who's just new to that space. Go earn your stripes, then you get to have an opinion about what we're doing, and you're able to get in position to be able to make decisions. I think on the back of that, you have to provide very, very regular, clear, and constant feedback. It's no benefit to anybody if we're not, one, being honest with everyone, but we're not telling anybody. There should be no surprises on people's quarterly, annual, biannual review. There should be no surprises in project reviews, because our job is meant to be providing that information as quickly and clearly as possible. And lastly, in terms of integrity, we've applied that to our hiring standard, right? We are not going to lower the bar, right? So this is one of the initiatives that we took in our talent management, right? No hire is a good hire. We don't hire loads of junior people. We would prefer in this environment to do more with less. Now that doesn't necessarily create a real good breeding ground for grads and things like that, but what we're trying to get done in the heavy rocks we need to move, that's not where we needed to be. So lastly, accountability, right? Own it, right? Take ownership of getting stuff done, right? Not just within your own team, but with the other teams as well. We know what's happening and we know where we're falling short, right? Understand your business, not just your specific asset class, not just your specific functionality that you need to test, but understand the business. When I first took over this team 2 years ago, I would go around and meet with project teams. Very few of them had met anybody in the business they support. That is not a good thing. We need direct exposure to these folks, right? And I think lastly, and if I could get anything printed on a t-shirt and branded, it would be manage your own expectations, right? If you're not being honest with people, if you're not telling people what your shortcomings are, do not expect them to understand how to help you or get where you want to get. No one is going to advocate better on behalf of yourself than you. So manage your own expectations while we're going through this process. So the change program, we'll call this change program phase one. There was a series of initiatives that were started before I joined the firm, and we called it the evolution program, and it ran for about half a year, but these are the core things that we looked at that were already running and decisions we made about them. So the first one was there is a pretty closely based test maturity model program that was running, aligned towards an industry standard. You know, we had reviewed a lot of programs and a lot of different projects and had come up with the basic terms of reference for how we're going to move up the value chain in terms of maturity. And every program was developing a improvement plan around their maturity model. So, killed it, right? First thing we did, thank you, James. The first thing we did was, he has not paid me to say that. The first thing we did was get rid of that. Now, hopefully we can have a continued conversation over this over a beer, but my personal opinion, because it's rather biased, but in terms of what we were doing at the time, I don't think you could, if you were going to design a bigger distraction for the teams, and aligning themselves towards business value and testing skills than the maturity program that was running. So we just opted to end that. The next program that we had was a metrics program, and it was based around, again, kind of your bog standard metrics, a lot of the counting of test cases and trying to find efficiencies. The other thing that we had was what we called program tracking sheets, where we basically identified, I think it was about 30-odd KPIs for how a program should be running, how we were doing against those, and tracking them on a regular basis. I think you can see where this is going. Killed that one as well, right? I read a little bit about metrics programs. I'm not a big fan of them, and I realized my kind of natural distaste for them growing up from a test analyst to test lead to test manager, primarily centered around why do I got to get measured differently than everybody else? We don't measure developers or program managers or BAs in any kind of way like that. So what is the point of measuring one specific process in isolation and trying to, with almost limitless dependencies and trying to isolate those together? So we killed that. And the way that I talked to our senior management about this, and I'm talking all the way up to the CIO of Barclays, is around, there's a really good book called Measuring and Managing Performance in Organizations, and they, thanks fellas, So anyway, they talk in that book, the guy who wrote it, and I'll forget his name right now, but he talks about metric dysfunction. And what that basically means is that as soon as you start applying a number to something you want to measure, people will instantaneously stop trying to deliver the spirit of the improvement you want to make and start trying to only improve that number. And the law of unintended consequences kicks in pretty quick, and you can come up with all sorts of problems. It is basically intentionally fogging the headlights of your onto your project. So we got rid of that as well. Also, it's very difficult to aggregate those metrics up to anything that's meaningful. So we killed that program. Lastly, I think we all know where this is going to end up, the career framework, right? So we have a career framework, but the one that we had, right, was very standard pyramid, and I always, again, find this very interesting, that the further you get away or up into the food chain, people want to get further away from their craft. And I tell my teams that, you know, even at the test manager level, people have 80%+ testing responsibilities, because if anybody's not going to work for a living around here, it's me. So we killed that. It's my favorite sound. So that's, now we're going to get into my first okay smarty pants moment, right? So we killed all our process improvement projects and try to think about what exactly are you then going to do? And here's what we did. All right, the entirety of our program focuses on talent management, and we've got a few things that programs that we're running in place of that. So the first one, and we just going to group them under attract, develop, and retain. All right, the first thing we did was a big employee review. All right, and what we want to do is raise the hiring bar, including the people who are existing. So we use some tools like top grading and reviewing to try and move people either up or out, right? Part of my job as the kind of pointy end of the stick for the GTC is to make sure it's really, 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 really hard to get into it. For a couple reasons. One, I think that's a natural attractor of talent. So people want to get into the hardest universities, people want to get in the hardest jobs. One of the reasons Google has such success with attracting top talent is because it's pretty damn hard to get into Google, right? So we want to have that same mentality, but I have pushed that out to the teams. They manage that through a series of reviews and how we've reconstructed the interview process, right? So I've transferred that over to the team. The next thing I try and do, as providing a lot of air cover, is to make sure that my job as a stakeholder manager for all the senior IT MDs and the CIO is that the GTC is positioned well within the firm. So I make sure they understand our core initiatives and make sure that we are continually viewed as a top project in the same vein as some of our technology projects. The next thing we're trying to do is on the development side. And I think if there's anything, any one thing that has completely changed the culture in the GTC is this. We have basically turned the entirety of our development program into staff-led training. And what that's done is they've developed about 10 different courses on, James is here, so I'll say rapid software testing. They've done their own implementation programs. Their classes based around test automation framework implementation, all sorts of different tools and utilities that they've built. And what the biggest thing that it's done is change the dialogue when something new happens, and they've set up a series of forums and working groups to try and manage this themselves, is that what this does, when something new enters the organization and it's kind of run the ringer, the first question people ask themselves now is, how do we push this out? Is this a WebEx? Is it a brown bag? Is it an actual course that we develop the materials around this? So it's completely changed the dynamic around a bunch of people complaining that they don't have any training, and almost instantaneously turned it on its head to, oh, we've got it. We can run our own training. We ask for no budget. We get no budget for this, and they do it all off their own back on top of their day jobs because they realize it's helping them move the ball forward for us as an organization. And I will tell you that at the highest levels of IT at Barclays, they watch this stuff. The GTC University that they've named was named by our MD head of client-facing technology. He's that interested in what we're doing. The next program that we kicked off, and if people want to talk about it later as well, I can give you more specifics on it when we have more time, is test management mentoring. And this is something that when we did our initial staff review, we realized that if we're going to change the dynamic of this organization, if we're not going to take the kind of bog standard maturity model metrics program approach to how we improve, man, we're short on those people who understand this. So we had to develop rather quickly a mentoring program and develop the next generation of leaders. I really, really am not a fan of external hires, particularly in the management positions. We do everything we possibly can to promote from within. And the last thing we did was take that career framework and flatten it out. One of the things I think that can be a huge distraction to people is when they're continually worrying about their grade and rank. So what we did was basically crush it down into four levels. We have a test analyst, test lead, test manager, and then my direct reports and me. And that's it. So we've got people with 10, 15 years experience who are test analysts, right? Because that badge doesn't necessarily have a negative connotation to it. What we try and focus on is not vertical movement, but lateral movement. Right? So are you getting the skills that you need? Have you worked in multiple asset classes? Have you worked in multiple regions? How do we facilitate more lateral movement, which frankly is a much larger contributor to low attrition than vertical? Because at some point, you get into a dead man's shoes situation and you can only go so high, and then people are waiting for me to go do something else and I'm not ready to do that yet. So the last thing we did is develop what we call these induction programs. And I think it's really important to tell people exactly what's expected of them, right? So that, one, I don't have to manage them that closely because they know already, and I do all our induction courses. And two, they know what to expect from me, right? So there's a little bit of a joke they call the induction program the Learning How to Work with Keith program. But that's fine. That's fine. I can live with that. But at the end of the day, it basically goes through a series of things to orient people in the organization and as well go through what we call the GTC management principles. So this has sources varying from Colin Powell to Ernest Hemingway to all sorts of people has been inspired by. It's a series of principles. You know, as Groucho Marx said, these are my principles. If you don't like these, I've got others. But at the end of the day, this is what we tell people and expect out of them when they join the organization. So I'll go through these one by one. You can take something away from it or have a giggle or stare at me in stunned silence as the teams do. But here we go. So one, people start ignoring testing when it's no longer relevant, right? In my organization, if people are ignoring you on the test team, that's your fault. Testing is basically the antidote to risk management, and that's what our primary job is. If you're running around with your 1,000-step regression pack and you miss three steps and it's therefore invalidated the last 3 months of your life and no one's listening to you, well, that's your fault. Speak the language of your programs. Learn what their values are, and people will not ignore you. Trust me, when I was a test manager, nobody ignored me, right? But at the end of the day, if you're not aligning yourself towards the value of your business, that's when people will start ignoring you. But in our role, that's your responsibility to figure that out. Take ownership of that and go get it done. Second point, being responsible sometimes means rocking the boat, right? And I use those words specifically, being responsible. You know, we are the only deconstructive process in a completely constructive process, right? And sometimes you're going to have to go tell Johnny that his code doesn't work. And Johnny's not going to be happy, right? Well, I don't care, right? As long as you're doing it in a respectful way, you can say whatever you want to people in my organization, right? And at the end of the day, being responsible means we're going to have to deliver rough news, right? That's what your job is. I hear sometimes people say, well, you know, testing is a service to the project. Yeah, but it's not a servant, right? And frankly, in our business, where there's still people in it who will take a strip off you just for sport, right? You're going to have to toughen up and not worry about it. If you want a friend, buy a dog. Point number three, no one has the market cornered on good ideas, right? If you think your boss, I doubt several of you do, if you think your boss or their boss, me, or even you, have all the good ideas, you're wrong, right? Bill Gates said, you know, you can put your bias to Bill Gates aside for a moment, that even the smartest people in the world, their entire lives, maybe, only have one good idea, right? You know where the good ideas are? Out there. Turn your neck. Talk to people next to you. Form relationships. Find out where someone might have solved it before, right? And that's where you're going to get some good ideas. And what we've tried to do is change the value system in the organization so that finding good ideas and reusing them is how people are graded, right? There's nothing that drives me crazier than someone going out to shoot the white elephant to impress me. I am not impressed by that. You know, the test center and your test teams and all these are basically funded by businesses who have deemed for whatever reason to give money to do some software testing. At some point, if they don't see the value in that any longer, they will take that money away. And being respectful of that means we need to be incredibly efficient with the resources that we've been given. So go out and find good ideas and solve problems collectively. Point four, never stop asking why. Aside from probably being the chisel in the tool and chisel of the tester's toolbox, you know, it is a clarifying question that will get you where you need to get to. There is nothing inside of our organization that is above the scrutiny of why. You know, nothing drives me crazier, aside from not collaborating and not reusing, than talking to somebody and reviewing their projects, and I do lots of project reviews myself, and asking them, why are you testing this way? Why is your strategy written this way? Why are you doing that? And I get the answer back, well, that's the way the program wants me to do it. That is probably the worst answer you could give. You are the testing expert, not the program. You're meant to advise on that. Don't mindlessly go about your job. Question why you're doing things, and it'll help you clarify your vision. Next point, invest 80% of your energy in your top 20%. Now, I use that as a time management technique, but I also, and it's not very politically correct in our everybody gets a medal on the soccer team mentality these days, but use that for people management as well. So when I was coming up in the world, there was what I called the leadership room. And those people made all the decisions, made the most money. They're the ones that got promoted, right? But there was no career path how to get in that group. No one was telling you the steps on how to do that, right? And as well, once you got in that room, you better figure out how to stay in it because they'll kick you out, right? So this point, probably more than any, my teams write down when we do the induction program because they're all trying to work out who's in that top 20%. But that's their problem, not mine. I want them to figure out their own path on how to do that. Next point. Leadership equals simplification, right? This stuff is complicated enough as it is. Let's not over-engineer solutions. And I think, in using that word leadership, this is one of the biggest issues that I find with my testing team is that they can't communicate simply about what they're doing. You have to be able to distill down rather quickly what we're doing in order to align yourselves towards value. And I'll give you an example of why. So I meet regularly with all the IT MDs in the firm. And I have about a 30-minute monthly meeting with them to go through just testing-specific issues. So I'll use this one example where, you know, I have a 30-minute meeting with him. Odds are, if he turns up, it'll be 10 minutes late. So now I'm down to 20 minutes. Hopefully, you know, he'll have something to say, you know, and it won't just be shouting at me. So that will be 10 minutes of that time. So now I'm down to 10 minutes that I've got left with him. 5 minutes of which hopefully I'll be responding to either the shouting or the questions, and that leaves me with about 5 minutes once a month to figure out not only what I want to tell him, but what I want to tell him so that he does something about it, right? That has to be incredibly simple, and that's not because he's stupid. He's an incredibly intelligent man. It's because he's got 1,500 people in his organization all trying to get that same 5 minutes. So if you want to be able to, you know, that's beyond an elevator pitch. That has to be laser-like in its focus so that he can then go articulate the value of what we're trying to do. Don't take it personally. I think if you can figure out by now, working with me, you got to kind of not take it personally. But at the end of the day, right, and I hate to burst this bubble for some people as well, you are not your ideas, right? Your ideas are made up of who raised you, where you were born, where you went to school, where you had your first job, the you know, type of coffee you had in the morning, your morning commute, who bumped your car in the parking lot, all those things conspiring together put a thought bubble above your head. Some days, it's got a light bulb in it. Other days, it's got a scribble in it. Change any one of those variables, right, and something else is going to pop into your head. But if you're taking all that personally, right, you don't like my idea, well, that means you don't like me, right? If you're walking around with your heart on your sleeve, you're going to have a really tough time in this environment, right? You won't be able to do any of this other stuff. You won't be able to question why, because if you're questioning your own ideas, you're questioning yourself, right? You won't be able to simplify things because I like complicated ideas, so that's what I like, so I can't change the way I do. If you're taking things too personally, right, you won't be able to change your behavior. So lastly, you know, and this is also echoed by what I tell my five-year-old son quite frequently, think first, then do, right? If we are doing all these things properly, we can be incredibly agile in how we respond to things. Facts change on the ground all the time. New information comes out, right? If we're applying all these things, we can change our minds. You know, we can act really quickly. And sometimes, you know, just acting like we're doing the right thing is sometimes as good as the real thing, right? So lastly, for the my second, well, how's that working for you, smarty pants moment? You know, we'll talk about how this actually is working. So I'll pick out a few things here that over the last 2 years we've seen as kind of genuine improvements. And, you know, without having a metrics program in place to be able to give you fancy numbers that are probably rather meaningless, we have to use a different set of barometer, really, to try and figure out how we're doing. One of those, the second point there, is that we've seen incredible uplift in the amount of investment in software testing in the firm. In terms of training, in terms of the hiring we've done, in terms of just general investment in what we do. So I think if you want to choose where people spend their money as a barometer of what they value, I think we're doing okay. Secondly, what we've seen is since we've removed all the kind of nonsense management overhead that we had, we've seen a complete bubbling up of new talent. So people who before were tucked under managers, who didn't really get the exposure, who didn't have access to the right resources or people, are now starting to do things like write regression testing utilities on their own, and it's coming in second place in the CIO award. That was done by, that is a misprint there, he's a test lead now, so sorry, Adrian. But 2 years ago, that wouldn't have even been possible that somebody would, and that is literally competing against a 7,000-person population. This guy's test harness that he wrote came in second place in the firm for the CIO award. The award that we came in second place, unfortunately, I didn't have any winners, but we got two runners-ups, which ain't doing too bad, that in our fixed income credit and commodities business was literally for her test strategy. So it was how she actually wrote, the value that was added to the project, and I didn't even submit it. The program manager on the development side submitted because they're so impressed with the work that she was doing. The other benefit that we've seen, based off of removing a lot of the nonsense, is a lot of automation projects started with no additional funding. All right, so we've started a whole bunch of stuff without having to go cap in hand every year to ask for additional funding for that. And I think really Once Barclays is done with me and we've done something else, or whenever that happens, I think really the biggest improvement or cultural change that we've implemented there is what we call this GTC University, which really is the structural bones of creating a learning organization. There's so many components to it, aside from the classroom-based training that we do, brown bags, the test management mentoring. They've created a couple different competitions for themselves, which are fantastic and incredibly hard, but basically off their own back. There's a training steer co that we've set up, but I don't do any of the actual work. I review some things, but this is literally off the back of what everyone is doing on top of their day job. And taking very little steer from me. So I think that, if anything, has taken a foothold. That's, and I've got more stories later if people want to ask about them. So QA transformation or leading cultural change, what does that really mean to me? You know, I think it's a paradigm shift. If you want to change the way people perceive your testing organization, change the way they view the value of your organization, I think you need to change the way you talk about it and the way you act. If you're not getting what you want out of that, a moment of self-reflection will hopefully determine that maybe it's some things that you're doing. So using the kind of standard stop, start, continue model, so if you want to do that, and we're 2 years into a program which I'm hoping will continue for many, many years to come, the first thing you do, stop pretending that the value of your testing organization is anybody else's responsibility. Right? If you're not getting any joy with the senior management, try and reflect on why that's happening, because I will guarantee you, 9 times out of 10, that's down to you and the way that the team runs. Right? And also stop pretending that you are going to mature out of that position, that metrics are going to do that or a maturity program is going to do that. You're going to do that through changing the perspective and the way in which they view you through, I think, intensive training and changing the way you talk about things. Start telling people exactly what you expect out of them, right? And I think, the testing community is particularly bad at this. We don't tell people what we should do in ourselves, and we don't tell people what they should expect out of us. And support that. You can't just tell people what to do. You have to support that by a training regime that gives them the tools, communication, soft comms, right? Really intensive workshops on how to do that, right? And lastly, if you really want to change the way your organization is viewed, create an environment that people are not afraid to fail. They have to feel that it's a safe environment to try new things. Stop judging people by how they do performance-wise in terms of not meeting their objectives and all the kind of bog standard things that we do, and basically create a learning organization through different types of measures and really give that feedback to them in a constant and clear way. That's it. Thank you. You want to take questions?
We have a couple minutes for questions and answers, but I want to do that first. How many of you work currently in an organization like Keith has described? How many would like to work in an organization like Keith has described?
Why are people raising their hands?
Those of you who don't, does it just sound too hard? I have a friend named Alan Kay who long ago said the best way to predict the future is to invent it. And rather than putting all this energy into trying to figure out what's going to happen, just put that same energy in making it happen. Keith has given us an interesting picture here of the way testing organizations could be, the way effective and efficient organizations could be. And I appreciate his coming to share this message. Now we have just a couple of minutes for Q&A. We have people with microphones. If you want to ask a question of Keith, please raise your hand. Wait till the microphone comes to you. That way everyone can hear. Got one here?
Thank you. Thank you. I have a question. So you mentioned that you get rid of the metrics and the maturity model as well. But I think management always have a fear or, you know, don't feel very comfortable when they do not see those graphs and charts, example, to show the test quality. So how do you manage this? Do you have the same feeling?
Yeah.
Or you trust your people?
Yeah, so I think there's two things for clarity, right? So we obviously track how many test scenarios we've tested at the project level. We obviously track how many test scenarios we've run that we said we're going to run. We do a lot of session-based test management, so we focus on that and track how many we've completed and where we are in that cycle. We don't aggregate it one degree beyond that. So I think you actually hit the nail on the head. If a manager is asking you for those level of metrics or a maturity assessment, they're afraid, right? So that gives them a level of security that I think is not real, right? So it looks like you want it to be true. You think it should be that simple. It is not. I mean, quality is a very subjective thing. I mean, I'm telling you, I can teach you guys how to suck eggs. You know what I mean? It's like, it's a very subjective thing. And if you know, one of the biggest differentiators, I think, for our organization is I have extremely enlightened management. And they trust me that we're going to make improvements, but we're not going to be able to measure them through how many test cases we counted.
Hey, Keith, you touched on the cultural change for the leading. So what do you recommend for the process changes?
I don't know, where are you? Okay, so what was the question again?
You touched most on the cultural change. So do you recommend anything towards process change?
We have taken a much more lighter approach towards just test management in general, but we've moved, you know, I would say agile in the small A, not really the kind of branded A, but it's difficult to say in any one specific example in terms of test process. So my remit covers the entirety of the investment bank and wealth management. Your risk profile and test approach for our algorithmic trading engines in the cash market is extremely different to maybe our intraday liquidity reporting that we have to do. So there's different test approaches that have to be applied. So we take very much a let's train everybody and everything as much as we possibly can so we can make really, really good decisions about which processes to use and in which different times. But I've got my own personal views, but again, they vary per project. Don't know if that answered your question.
Hey, Keith. A lot of us would like to implement such a fantastic center of excellence in our organizations, but
it's a work in progress.
Yeah. Did you get any pushback from your management? And if you did, you know, how did you overcome some of the resistance that you got?
Yeah. So my view on that is that's why I meet regularly with the MD. So we get pushback sometimes more at the kind of program level or project level. But if I'm doing my job right and managing, I have a monthly meet with our CIO who runs the whole of IT, and you know, we talk just about testing. So if I'm doing my job right and aligning our objectives towards his, then there's complete congruence there. When it gets down to a project level where they don't want to try exploratory testing or they don't want to do a different technique or use a utility, I generally win those arguments because there's no escalation path. But it's you know, you butt heads with some people, but I'm happy to have those battles as well. You know, I think it keeps your teeth sharp.
Hey. Hi. I wanted to ask you, what sort of automation tools do you use, and do you build them in your like development team for a custom application, or do you use open source? Thanks.
It's all over the board. So we've got some big third-party relationships like HP, where we use QuickTest Professional and Performance Center and all the other kind of good stuff. We also probably focus more on building our own utilities. So particularly around the trading systems, trying to do that from the UI is pointless. So we build more harnesses. We've built our own test automation framework that works with things like Test Complete and QuickTest Professional. But again, our technology portfolio is all over the board. So I'd say our tendency is to lean more towards kind of throwaway automation where we build simple harnesses and then move on. We're also taking, and actually the debate has kind of sparked up again in the organization, this theory called whole team automation, which we're trying to employ, which is basically in the 21st century, you know, every tester needs to understand test automation, needs to do that. So we're trying, we can't afford to have a consulting model internally, so everybody needs to be able to write scripts and deploy them in all sorts of different tools. But our technology portfolio is all over the board, and we've got lots and lots of stuff in-house. One of the cool things that they've built is what they call, and this is the our specialist test team, is what they call their e-tools depot, where everybody can log in internally, and if you build something, you have to put it on this depot so that with a little user manual, so these are like massive data comparison tools and things like that. Somebody give James a mic before he jumps out of his shoes. And then be ready to take it away rather quickly. That's it. Question done. Over here first.
Hey, Keith. Can you share with us the top three challenges that you faced and how you handled while moving your focus from some of the existing programs to more talent mindset?
Yeah. Interestingly enough, so people usually want to focus on, oh, you just killed those three programs. People probably went bananas. Actually, when we really went through it, people didn't have, the testers had a bigger problem with it than the programs because, or the technology managers, because nobody really knew what the heck they were doing anyway, right? So it was pretty easy to kill those programs. Our biggest challenges usually are around keeping people focused. Hiring is very hard for us, so getting people with that mind frame. I mean, you're talking about 20 years of getting certifications and metrics programs and maturity models hammered into every, you know, I mean, cover your ears, Lee. That's hurt a lot of what I'm trying to do, because we don't want people in that mind frame. So we take them on and brainwash them, but a lot of times they blow up. So hiring, keeping people focused, and as well, I'd say the general scope of what we're trying to do, and in a distributed environment where we've got people in Singapore, India, Kiev, Glasgow, New York, London, Hong Kong, Tokyo, you know, teams all over the board. So really trying to cross those divides of communication and kind of the cultural differences and everything else is just a continuing challenge.
I have a question back here.
Let me get in the hook?
No.
Okay.
One question from the virtual audience. Could you explain what you mean by saying transfer quality ownership to the team?
Yep. So instead of having a very top-heavy terms of reference-based model where we're hiring to profiles and things like that, we've changed our approach so that there's more kind of short mid-level interviews amongst the teams themselves, and they have a much heavier hand in actually doing the hiring. And as well, by doing the induction programs and then actually making the functional teams develop their own induction programs, that means that they're looking at people differently as to who they want to bring in their teams. And when I say the functional teams develop their own induction programs, so like the equities testing team has to literally, they've literally sat down and done just like we did for the GTC. Who are the folks? Who's important? What are our values? What are we working on? And then they hire to those. So instead of me trying to tell everybody what they should be looking for, we let the individual teams manage that.
There seems to be a basic contradiction that I've heard in your talk. I'm puzzled by it. On the one hand, you seem to demand excellence, and you got your 2080 thing, and you get into the room by being good enough, and then you have to cling on to that and stay in the room. And then at the end you say, and drive out fear. Totally drive out fear. How can you drive out fear and yet be so demanding that people perform well and get better?
Because it's not a bad thing to fail. That's why. So by removing the kind of negative connotation of screwing up, you remove that base fear, or at least try to as best you can, because some people still can't break out of that mind frame. And I think as well, wanting to have people excel I don't view those things as counterintuitive or mutually exclusive. I don't think having a very demanding technical and project environment and letting people screw up as mutually exclusive, right? Those are two separate things. And it's hard. We work in a hard business. Everybody here is in some way, shape, or form been touched probably by the financial environment we're in. So, you know, if you don't smarten up, you know, then you end up getting cut, right? So that's the way it works. And what I try and do, and it's kind of the pointy end of the stick for this, is to be as open, and you've seen me do it, James, right? I am incredibly open and transparent with my team about what's working, what's not working for me, sharing experiences, and really try to lead from the front by that, because when they see me doing it, then they'll start to do it as well. But I don't view those things as mutually exclusive. I mean, you fly planes, right? Are you afraid when you fly planes?
I agree with you. Yeah. Dude, great answer.
Okay. Two more questions. Any virtual ones? I'll give you a virtual answer. Okay.
How much time do you use on knowledge sharing or training of the team? For example, percentage of the working hours?
I let them manage it themselves. You know, our first port of call is getting project work done. But we've seen them manage it on their own. Lots of people work, you know, longer hours to do it. But then once we get a course developed or we've got something that we want to push out, we try and do it through a couple ways. One, we have a weekly brown bag session where it's an hour and a half where people can do knowledge sharing in a structured way. And it's really cool because all the teams, we found the time when everybody can do it. So when you log in, there's people in Kiev, in India, in Glasgow, in Singapore, all hearing the same information at the same time. We also use WebEx a lot, so a lot of our little tools and utilities we've built, people can do that from their home if they want and log in and see the demo and look at the user manual and understand how to use the tools. And then honestly, we've worked with our learning and the Barclays Learning and Development Group to put our course catalog into their standard thing. So you can go in, log into that system, sign up for the GTC induction course, and that gets blocked out of your time just like you would if you were taking any other approved training. So again, it's not a usual environment that people are that open to doing things like this, but we've partnered with the right people internally, and as well, we've tied in our learning and development activities into the career framework. That's the Barclays career framework. One last thing I point out as well before we'll take your questions, that if people are questioning how serious the firm is about their commitment to this program, we just recently have had our objectives and my objectives tied into the technology roadmap. And it's basically laying out the next 3 years of what Barclays wants to accomplish technology-wise, and software testing, our training program, our hiring process, and all that kind of stuff. Our test automation frameworks have actually been added, and that's the CIO runs that. So he's actually added that stuff into our technology roadmap. They're very serious about software testing. It's nice.
Your answer just now actually leads into part of my question. You've developed a culture of professionalism, which is absolutely marvelous, and it sounds like it's thriving in a culture of recognition. So my question is about how pervasive is this culture of recognition at Barclays? Can you comment on that?
Yeah, we have, without naming names, our CIO, you can look him up, this guy named Joe Squeery, he has a very enlightened view of career management and training, and if he's not a people guy, he's really, really, really good actor. So he really takes a lot of this to heart, and I think we're undergoing, and I can't speak on obviously on behalf of the firm, but I sense that there's a renewed energy towards personal development, and he bangs on just like I do, bangs the drum for collaboration and reuse. So he set up instantly when he came in a lot of programs around that. He set up a technical excellence and quality group that was completely congruent with a lot of the stuff that we were already doing. So I think as a firm, we're moving in the right direction. And I think this is, you know, we are have completed phase one of the kind of cultural overhaul. Now it's about making sure we continue to water that and make sure we're keep moving in the right direction. Am I getting the hook? Okay. Thank you very much.
That wraps up this event, and thank you for joining us. Now, please check the Presentation Center for other presentations and their start times. And don't forget, join us for our live interviews between presentations. See you at our next show.